please join. So now it would be good to have the point of view of the academic, the researcher. José Manuel comes from the Polytechnical University of Madrid, and he is involved in the HPV for All project. I think I mentioned it earlier, which is about connected TV and accessibility. And I think it's quite close to some things we discussed already this morning. It's also about deployment, but deployment in terms of pilots. There will be some user tests, and these user tests will go out to, I would say, pilots. And if we say pilots, that means that we try to get a kind of model that makes that it's viable. So perhaps. Not so long. I know it is a fascinating thing when we hear you, but I think your microphone is working. And what would be interesting is perhaps at the end to address some ideas about what could be future research ideas, future research and innovation ideas.
Okay, thank you, Hartmut, for inviting us to participate in this event. Please excuse me because I thought that I had about, I don't know, 20 minutes or so to make a presentation, and so I prepared some slides. Now that I know that I have 3, 4, 5 minutes, okay, let me go very quickly, not through the slides, but only to maybe make some support, I mean to use some figures and some data that I have there. I will pass through them very quickly, just highlighting some issues. As you can see, I'm here to present the HPV for All project. The HPV for All project is a European project which has just started last December, and it will extend for 3 years. The HPV for All acronym stands for Hybrid Broadcast Broadband for All, which is a technology which is not completely new, but now it seems that we are getting to spread it in the market. So HPV for All, the HPV for All project is a user-centered project. We have very much in mind the users, although as you will see in the consortium that we have a lot of technicians. Sorry for that. What are we planning to do in the project? What we are planning to do is to use HBB TV technology. HBB TV stands for Hybrid Broadcast Broadband Television, right? Hybrid in the sense that we are planning to combine the traditional broadcast channel, the broadcasting system that we all use at home. In different countries it is used more or less, I mean through terrestrial broadcasting or through satellite, that broadcasting channel together with the broadband channel that most of us have at home, the ADSL connection through which we can interact and connect to internet. A lot of people is not aware that we can combine both channels in the same television in the same system, so that currently what are called smart TVs are able to receive information both from the classical broadcasting channel and from the internet connection that we have at home, and can switch from one to the other, and hopefully in the future, not now, to combine the signal that we receive from both of them in a synchronized way. This is something that is currently being developed inside this standard, HBBTB, and this is what we are planning to implement in this project, right? Is that a good summary? Okay, let's go fast. We are planning to deploy 4 big pilot test in this project, and we are targeting different user groups. We are not only addressing the ordinary user groups, people with some kind of impairment, but we are also addressing some other groups, in particular professionals in education and healthcare, and some other activities or environment in which this technology could be applied. Obviously associations that could receive the benefits of these technologies, research groups, obviously, and you will see that in the consortium we have a couple of them. Bodies dealing with standardization, and we want to participate in this standardization group, and governments, because there is a big issue at the end related with the question that I pose, which is the sustainability of this big theme, right? This is the consortium, 12 partners. I will not go into the details of each of them. What I want to show you or to highlight is that we have 4 public broadcasters from different countries that will participate in the pilot test. Research institutes, universities, including mine, and SMEs. Well, as I'm going very fast in the slides, I hope that at least I could leave them somehow so that the people may download if they want. Right. So we have 4 pilots. Going very quickly. One dealing with subtitling, right? One dealing with subtitling. A lot of things have been commented about subtitling. Something that has surprised me very much this morning is that when people was commenting about personalized subtitling system, they were speaking about additional screens, maybe tablets, maybe computers, but they were not speaking about receiving the information in the TV set. And this is something that we can receive currently thanks to this standard. So we can try to obtain personalized subtitling in the same TV set that we have at home. We don't have the need to go to special devices, even though we can go if we want. Okay? So one is dealing with subtitling, and the subtitling pilot that we are deploying, as the rest of the pilots that we are going to launch, is not only dealing about the application that the user will see. We are addressing also professionals, and we are trying to cover the complete value chain. This implies that in order to provide these services, this service, we need to go to the production site. So the production and content generation probably has to consider that this service has to be provided. And in the production side, we need to change the workflow. And this is something which is required. And probably this is one of the drawbacks for the deployment of this type of service since many years ago. You were commenting that in 2010, you already participated in one project that was deploying this kind of service. I can tell you that we have been starting to provide these services maybe in 2006. 2005. So even before, the question is that at that time the availability of standards or standardized ways to provide this was not available. Currently we are trying to complete this, right? So HBBTV is not, well, it's more or less complete, but we still have some work to do. Going fast, pilot B is dealing with alternative audio. You were speaking about additional accessibility services apart from the common one. One of them is clean audio. Clean audio for people that is not very fluent in the language that you want to give him the information he needs to learn, or maybe he has some kind of auditive impairment. So for them, clean audio is something which is important, and this is something that we are planning to do. Again, as you can see in the drawing, receiving the information in your TV set as well as in some other screens, maybe tablets, computers, or whatsoever. But again, in your TV set, which is important, you don't need to use another device if you don't want or you don't have. The third pilot is dealing with the personalization of those services. We are trying to personalize the provision of those services as much as possible, following the recommendations given by a previous project whose name was GUIDE, Gentle User Interfaces for Elderly People, right? And the fourth one is a sign language pilot that will be deployed into different countries, one of them making use of the HBB technology in Germany, and using the same technology that we are going to develop in the project, using a personal computer in Portugal, right? So these are the 4 pilots. As it is clear, the project is very well aligned with the digital agenda for Europe. If it not were the case, probably the Commission wouldn't have funded the project, so there must be a reason for that. It is clear that the digital agenda is promoting the usage of information and communication technologies in order to enhance the lifestyle of all the citizens, in particular people with some kind of impairment. And we shouldn't forget that as we grow old, and I'm growing old, we all start to have impairment. I am visually impaired, maybe my auditive system is getting worse, so we shouldn't think about people who from the medical point of view has been assigned as a kind of impaired person. Probably most of the people which is in this room, we are a bit impaired. Think that we are using glasses, why? Research challenges that you commented in 2 minutes. Okay, we have many. I have highlighted some of them, and let me put some stress on some of them. A concept which is very important, and maybe Scott has just commented about that. Maybe as in some other environment, accessibility should be something that should be considered by design. What I'm referring to is that everything should be considered from the very beginning, from the generation till the consumption, that has to be done in a way that has to be accessible. You were commenting about building or making movies in a special way to make them accessible, right? Mm-hmm. Production must also be changed in order to allow the deployment of accessibility services. Transmission is something that we have to tackle if we want the accessibility services to be provided. The interface with those services is something that also needs to be revised, and we could go on. So accessibility by design should be a concept that we should think about it and implement, right? The other question that I pose this afternoon is the business model behind accessibility. Okay, it is clear that sustainability is an issue, and the market is so strong, that is driving many times what is happening. Believe me, HBBTB is a standard that is, it is not completely implemented by the manufacturers. Why? Because the manufacturers are reaching alternative agreements with some entities like Google, Facebook, with some other organizations in order to provide what they call the closed garden. And a closed garden is something similar to HBBTB, but is particular for that manufacturer. And when I'm speaking about manufacturer, I'm speaking about really big ones such as, I'm forgetting a lot, but maybe Sony, LG, Samsung, Philips, all of them are trying to get agreement, particular agreement with different entities to provide what they call the closed garden. That implies that we, if using that closed garden, that perhaps may provide accessibility services, those services will be completely deleted and governed by the manufacturer. So a general evolution and a standardization of the provision of that service will never be reached unless we use a standard. So HBBTB is the standard to fight against those closed gardens. The business model is important, and if we finally reach to deploy the standard, we need some support, and the support should come from government, stakeholders, standardization organization, so that. Many things to speak about. Research challenges, many of them. Technology is evolving a lot. The classical services that we were providing since 10 years ago probably may evolve. In the past, many attempts have been done to provide new services. For example, you may know that in the case of signing, some trials were launched using some kind of avatar. And the avatar was rejected by the signing people because they thought that they were artificial, not very human, and blah, blah, blah. Okay. Since then, the technology has evolved a lot. I have inserted here a picture of a game that one of my boys is using every day at home. I don't like very much the game because of the violence which is behind, but I got really surprised when the first time I saw it, because of the natural way people was moving. The avatars are so realistic, the movement of the people is so realistic, the faces, the behavior, that the first thing I thought was, wow, what incredible would be to use that technology for the provision of accessibility, because perhaps now the provision of signing, which is something very, very limited for the cost it implies, could be expanded. So this is something that we should think about. Technology is evolving a lot. Computer vision possibilities are growing. The text, speech and synthesis, speech synthesis and so on is evolving a lot. So many things can now be started. And conferences such as this one, in which users and technicians are put together, mainly to reach some new ideas that could be implemented in the future. You have commented also about the possibility to expand the application of those services to new environments, such as, for example, movie making, maybe art making. In Spain we have some artists which are starting to begin their creative initiative thinking about accessibility issues, which implies that they are planning not only to reach ordinary users, to call them somehow, but also people with some particular disability or some particular impairment. And this is difficult, and as you commented, that it requires a bit of creativity and imagination in order to think or to put yourself in the shoes of a person that has that impairment, and to try to think as he would think when he is enjoying that piece of art. And okay, many things that that could be done, but in these 3 minutes that Hartmut gave me, some conclusions. The technology is evolving. Projects such as HBB for All are pushing beyond the limits and using the standards, which are very important. The accessibility needs are also growing and evolving in different domains, but we need to involve many actors in the whole value chain. And even though we are all convinced here in this table that sustainability shouldn't be an issue, and perhaps accessibility is something linked with the concept of public service, I really believe that the market is so strong that we really need to push strongly to keep the accessibility services still going on and through standardized ways. Okay, thank you. In 2 minutes.